I don't know.
Say it with me. I don't know.
Good God, it is liberating. I am a towering mountain of ignorance. I don't know.
We're taught to believe that everything has a reason.
Now, I'm glad that we have the desire to understand the world. That results in all sorts of great stuff.
We want to know everything. We're humans. We're curious. And maybe it's our culture. Maybe it's just humanity.
But I think a lot of the time we end up mixing up thinking something with knowing something.
Suddenly, I know that I don't know, but somehow everyone else seems to know.
They all know differently from each other, but they all seem to know.
What I'm saying is nobody's opinions are correct in the world.
And yet, it's impossible not to tie your opinions to your concept of self.
And often people tie those things so closely together that they begin defending their guesses as if they're defending their very lives.
In a way, they are.
This is why it can be so impossible to talk about certain topics with certain people.
They've tied those suppositions to themselves so tightly with knots of narrative and constructed reality and values that there's just no untying it.
And maybe unsurprisingly, in those situations, the best course of action is just to be friends.
The world as we perceive it, as we've built it inside of ourselves, is a lie that we tell to ourselves, not out of deception, but out of necessity.
We simply cannot understand the world as it is, and so we construct.
But sometimes I just have to tell myself the thing that is definitely true, the truest thing I can say, which is that I don't know.
This is the Everyone's Agnostic Podcast with Bob Pondillo and Cass Midgley.
Welcome, everyone, to episode 201 of the Everyone's Agnostic Podcast. I'm Cass Midgley. Today, Bob Pondillo and I interview David Burns. David is now 50 and was a lifelong Mormon. He unpacks his passion for Mormonism, how it was his life, his tribe, his identity. He served his two-year door-to-door mission, and it was there that his faith in Mormonism experienced its first crack. I fell in love with David during this talk. He's really sharp and a gentle man, and it comes through here. He's on the Asperger spectrum, and his lifelong tendency to interpret everything literally contributed to his devotion to the wacky foundations of Mormonism and eventually his departure. I can't help but wonder if the need for human beings to find a tribe isn't a primary motivator behind the formation of and devotion to religions. We need to belong. Loneliness is so scary, and communities are one of the most beautiful things that humans form. There's hardly anything more fulfilling and life-enriching than finding yourself at a party or in a circle of friends to which you truly belong and are genuinely celebrated, loved, and supported in your truest form. When you're celebrating a promotion at work, or a new house, or a new baby, or marriage, or a birthday, and you have a community of people around you that organize a celebration and or send you cards in the mail or bring you gifts, what better feeling is there? As human beings, we are aware of so much more than the animal kingdom. We know that the universe is big, dark, and impersonal. We know that the world is a difficult place with its unpredictable weather and tragic happenstances. Animals don't get overwhelmed. We alone feel alone on this dirt clod hurling through space. We can feel adrift with nothing solid to hold on to. We can even be surrounded by people and still feel totally alone. We can live in a city and feel no roots or connection to it. We look to our spouses and our children for some grounding and belonging, but we can end up putting too much burden on them to validate and rescue our drowning, bankrupt self-esteem. We ache for friendships. Without them, we can feel lost, that the world is closing in on us, that nobody understands us, and we can become disgusted with humanity and quickly lose any desire to remain on this selfish, exclusionary planet. But when suicide is not an option, we re-enter the world, but in an angry, scared survival mode. We become racked with suspicion and distrust of others, further isolating ourselves. Our default is to blame others for our problems, and then we turn that blame inward, spiraling us deeper downward into self-loathing. Unconscious, of course, nothing about this type of person is conscious. Pretty quick, we see ourselves as victims, and thus martyrs, for our tail-chasing cause. So what do? Our tribal instincts kick in, and we find other disenfranchised people lost and lonely. Misery loves company, right? Safety in numbers. We rally with pitchforks to avenge our insulted egos against our enemies, and the mere fact that we've formed a common enemy endears us to others, and the next thing you know, we've got a tribe. And it's not a healthy tribe. It brings out the worst in us. It fosters resentment, contempt, and bitterness. It appeals to and compounds the lower angels of our nature, fearful, insecure, hateful, and our hatred for ourselves gets projected onto our unknowing enemies. On April 24th, Alec Manassian, the 25-year-old Canadian man who killed 10 and injured 15 as he drove a van down a one-mile stretch of sidewalk in Toronto, was allegedly a part of a tribe called the Incel Rebellion. Incel is short for involuntary celibate. In other words, men who can't form relationships, or, more crudely, can't get laid. And because of the internet, this group is said to have grown 5,000 members strong. Their common denominator is that they're furious at constantly being rejected by women. In the following conversation with our guest, you're going to hear David talk about the strength of the Mormon community and the excruciating pain of detaching himself from his lifelong tribe that was precious to him, especially as one who'd felt excluded and rejected all his life for being different. He, like many of us, threw himself headlong into the ministry he loved. It gave him purpose and identity and community. Life was good and somewhat easy. What on earth would pry us out of those deep, loving relationships? Relationships with our Heavenly Father, our dear friend Jesus, our constant companion the Holy Spirit, and most of all, our fellow human sojourners. What would make us leave? The undeniable, eye-opening discovery that it's a delusional way of living? The corruption? The underbelly? The greed? The exclusivity? I watched the movie Come Sunday this week about the withering of Carlton Pearson's ministry as he came out as a universalist and began preaching what he called the gospel of inclusion. It's on Netflix. It was produced by Ira Glass and the This American Life staff. I recommend it, but with a warning. You'll see the excruciating pain of Carlton praying and praying and crying out to God as his life was falling apart, but the heavens were silent. You'll see the tug of war on his heart as his giant ministry dwindled to a handful of people, all because he wouldn't recant or backpedal from his convictions that no one was in hell and Jesus saved everyone. What Carlton came to learn was that evangelicals really love their hell. At times he can't believe the indignation he witnesses just because he believed Jesus saved everyone. How is this bad news? Brennan Manning, an author I loved when I was a Christian, gave this definition of Phariseeism. When you see love and grow indignant, you're a Pharisee. Carlton Pearson, like some of us, lost everything. His income and career, his friends, even family. And this is why this podcast exists. I believe the power and pull and magnetism of community is at the core of why people unfriend us as soon as they perceive that we're saying something or believing something outside the beliefs of the community. In their minds, they have to make a choice, and quickly, between you and the giant construct by which their lives are held together. They call it God. I'm sure it breaks their hearts to leave us, but deciding to ditch us is probably much less difficult a decision than the one we're making. People have no idea how hard it is to leave one's faith, and they don't want to know. They don't want to have that idea, so they scoot us out of their lives as quickly as they can, lest they begin to entertain the same questions that led us away. The music stops, and all the children scramble to plant their ass in a chair, so they're not the ones left standing without one. People who gather under the banner of mutual hate get their identity from without. Their actions are reactive. They're hollow people. They are defined by what they hate, not what they love. They don't even know what they love because they lack the self-awareness and agency to ask themselves to go within. They are all around no-sayers. They pout in self-pitiful tantrums that nothing is the way it should be. They say no to the persons, bodies, and psyches in which they find themselves, no to the people who are different, no to the harsh realities of existence, no to the abyss of random chaos in which they find themselves. They are ill-equipped to be overcomers, to find true meaning in this meaningless life. They fall under the trance of some fairy tale that keeps them childish, and they're lazy. Making lemonade is hard work. Our human proneness to tribalism can be used to elevate ourselves at others' expense. We can take so much pride in our community that we move into feeling superior to other communities. We can live our lives fueled by comparing ourselves to others and competing with other tribes for power. Even healthy communities can fall prey to this trap. Perhaps you've been a part of a book club or a small house church or Bible study where members bond and look forward to seeing each other each week or month. Then someone invites a friend, and you can feel the elementary school resentment wrinkle its nose at the invader. Now, this isn't entirely evil or immature. I personally reserve the right to pick my friends and close the door on new seekers because the chemistry is good and might be disrupted by introducing new blood. I think everybody's free to do that without shame. And the point is that relationships and communities are complicated and nuanced and even a bit fragile and have always been that way. The magic is so intense and the dynamics so delicate that friendships and communities that last a lifetime are extremely rare, and you're lucky if you pull that off. Even marriages have a much higher chance of losing their luster than remaining vibrant for the long haul. So here we find ourselves, looking for love, for connectivity, for our tribe, our people. These magical relationships don't just happen. They form because we foster them intentionally. We set out to find friends, schedule get-togethers, keep in contact, constantly navigating the feelings. Are they mutual? Do they like me as much as I like them? Am I smothering? Can I be myself and them still like me? Is there a breaking point on the horizon, a deal breaker? And if years go by with dozens of dinners, engagements, parties under your belt, and the intimacy is only deepening, you've won the lottery. You've hit the jackpot. Because two or three or seven hominids getting together, enjoying each other for a long period of time, is a rare and precious thing. We taped this conversation on April 14th, 2018.
We interview people you don't know about a subject no one wants to talk about. We hope to encourage people in the process of deconstructing their faith and help curb the loneliness that accompanies it. We think the world is a better place when more people live by sight, not by faith. Please subscribe to our podcast and leave a review wherever you listen to podcasts.
Also, we offer these podcasts freely and with no advertisements. And your support truly makes a difference. You can support us monetarily in two easy ways. You can pledge a monthly donation through Patreon. That's patreon.com/EAPodcast. Or you can leave a lump sum donation through PayPal at our website, everyonesagnostic.com. Our opening monologue is an excerpt from a YouTube by Hank Green titled Towering Mountain of Ignorance. The music behind it is Never Know by Jack Johnson. And the segue music on this episode is Wake Me Up by Dirty Loops. Thank you for listening, and be a yes-sayer to what is.
Hey, Bob.
Hey, David, how are you?
Real good, good.
All right.
It's got a good sound.
Boy, it sounds terrific. Yeah.
I went out and bought a $70 on sale microphone from Best Buy for podcasting.
Wow. Whoa. Great.
This is going to be great. I'm really.
Yeah.
It's like I get right. excited when it sounds good, man.
Yeah.
It's hard to listen to an hour and a half conversation where audio's weak.
But absolutely.
That is exactly what I figured.
Yeah.
Well, very good,
Dan. And you're going to go by your name. I mean, like, how out are you?
Well, I'm only semi out, but you know what? I'm 50 years old. I've got two kids. I need to set an example and live authentically. I don't want them to hide who they are. So I'm using my real name, Dave Burns.
All right.
All right, Dave. You got it.
And someone doesn't like it, that's their problem.
Yeah,
it really is.
Well, yeah, you know, Bob and I were just talking. I still love this thing that Shan taught back in her episode where she said you have two needs, to be authentic and to belong. And a lot of social constructs force you to make a choice between those two.
Yeah.
So you're either going to be authentic but not belong, mm-hmm. or you're going to be disingenuous, but the group will accept you.
Yeah.
That's spot on.
Yeah. Yeah. And this is why it's even a thing that atheists don't come out.
Yeah. Well, what a terrible way to live, though. Well, to always be imitation of yourself, you know? You're not even...
authentic.
You're not authentic,
well,
exactly.
And that's why things like the Facebook group for this show and this show in general, that the reason it appeals to some people is at last I can be authentic mm-hmm. and be included.
Right.
And belong.
Right.
This is that sweet place where both can happen.
Yeah.
It's so nice to start making friends where you can just let your hair down and be yourself.
Yep.
Yeah, absolutely.
Well, the non-judgmental environment, man, it's just a beautiful thing.
Yeah. Why is that Christianity, or even Mormonism in this case, why is it, why do people behave that way? What's the problem?
why do they act inauthentically to fit in? Or
yeah.
Yeah, that too. Why?
Well, it's just there's so much pressure on you in Mormonism, and it's... you're indoctrinated from the time you're a kid, and there's so much pressure, and people treat you differently, and oftentimes severing those relationships or damaging them. So there's really tremendous pressure just to keep your head down and not make waves.
Yep.
Huh.
Yeah.
Gee whiz. So to best embrace the faith, be it Mormonism or Christianity or whatever, you have to be inauthentic.
You know.
I think it would all fall apart if authenticity was encouraged, because there's one correct way of thinking.
Yeah.
And when you deviate, you get hammered down. And if everyone went around just saying what they wanted and expressing different ideas, it would be like an out of control virus. It would spread and it would just fall apart.
Well, and that's the point, is that when you have a social construct that forces you to choose, they know that in order for this social construct to stay in place, that's what he's saying, is that people have to be, to some degree, disingenuous.
Yeah.
So let's go back to your childhood. It sounds like you were raised Mormon.
Yes, I am Mormon from birth. So one thing about me that will help you understand my story, I think I have a mild case of Asperger's, or somewhere mild on the autistic spectrum. I'm very functional, but the thing it does is two things. Especially younger, it made it really hard for me to socialize. I was just very awkward. And the second thing it did, I took things very, very literally. Mm-hmm. You know, and my son's like that. If my son misbehaves and I say, "Hey, I'm going to sell you to the circus if you keep doing that," he takes that very literally. "I don't want to go to the circus." You know, yeah. I want to stay here. So So the overriding thing that kind of ruled over my life when I was young is my father passed away when I was 9 months old of Lou Gehrig's disease. That's the same thing Stephen Hawking had.
Right. Wow.
So I never knew him. And my mother, she was also somewhere on the Asperger's, undiagnosed, but I'm convinced of it. She has all the symptoms. Mm-hmm. She used to tell me that she knew that he went. So let me preface this. Mormons have what they call the word of wisdom. Don't drink coffee, tea, alcohol. It's very big. It's hard to be a active Mormon if you partake in those substances. And she used to tell me that she knew that if he hadn't smoked and drank, he wouldn't have died. Mm-hmm. And I took that very literally. I believed her. And I used to think, you know, why did you love your cigarettes and your beer more than us kids?
Yeah.
You know, and it really caused resentment against my father that was unfair. You know, but in my black and white world, there weren't shades of gray. So I really resented him.
Sure.
And on his deathbed, he told my mother not to get married again or not to date again. And she was in her early 40s. Mm-hmm. And she took that advice. She promised and she upheld her promise. And basically she sentenced herself to 40 years of living alone, not open to any possibilities, because she was worried, what she had told me, she was worried that when she died, she would meet him on the other side in heaven, and he would be angry or disappointed in her if she had married or dated.
Wow.
My gosh.
This is the extent of the reach.
Wow.
Oh, yes, yes. So basically, my mother was in poor health. We grew up very, very poor. We grew up in a inner city neighborhood, and where I was on the autism spectrum, it was just so hard to fit in. Mm-hmm. There weren't many kids that looked like me. There were great kids, and I didn't have any problem growing up there, but I just didn't really fit in. I never felt like I fit in fully.
Well, what did you look like?
Well, basically, I was one of the few white kids in the whole neighborhood. It was very Hispanic. It was Arizona. All my friends were Hispanic. Great friends, wonderful. You know, didn't have anything bad happen to me very much. It was the exception to the rule.
They weren't something. They bad. Weren't rapists.
No, no, come on. No, they weren't. They were.
Well, they're Mexicans. There you go. Right. So yeah.
Well, you know, I'm sure that you know. Nasty. It's just like any culture. There's good and bad people everywhere.
Of course.
Of course. Oh,
yeah. We're just kidding.
Yeah. And I didn't, you know, occasionally.
Oh, wait, just right then, you took that literal.
Oh, yeah.
Did you catch that?
Yeah.
He literally is like, oh, no, they're not rapists. And I was kidding, right? Because that's abstract. That, case in point. That's
part of what I do, you know, and I'm better now.
No, it's cool. It's not, I'm just observing.
But, you know, when you combine that with, like, being very religious, it's just.
Oh, yeah.
It makes your life tough, you know, when you're literal.
Sure.
And see, I thought I was pretty much moving past that, but apparently, no, I'm still.
Well,
I still do that.
Oh, no, that was minor. I was just pointing.
Yeah,
that.
Absolutely.
Well, here's the thing: we've always said on the show that we're not anti-religious as much as we are just anti-dogmatic or anti-literal.
Right.
I mean, we have people on the show. I have friends that are progressive Christians, and they literally embrace the scriptures as metaphor. They don't believe in Adam and Eve. Mm-hmm. They don't even believe that Jesus was some kind of substitutionary atonement or whatever. They just are very loosey-goosey. And there are people that aren't on the spectrum that take it literal, but you had a predisposition to take it even more literal, maybe.
I took it very literal. Yeah. And these normal social relationships were just a mystery to me for so long. It was like a mysterious puzzle. I just didn't get it.
Now, how did that manifest? Like, when you watched a normal relationship, what kind of behavior did you see that you didn't understand or relate to?
Well, when I was, you know, younger, I just didn't see how, like, the opposite sexes would like each other. And even not just because I hadn't gone through puberty, but it just was a mystery. And, you know, when I started dating, when I was, you know, let's say 16, 17, if a girl sees a guy she wants to meet, she might come up to him and say, you know, you look familiar. Where do I know you from? Mm-hmm. And it's just an opening to talk to the guy.
Right.
Yeah. I didn't realize that. I would spend the next half hour trying to figure out where I'd met her, and she would throw her hands up in frustration and make an excuse and leave.
Poor guy. It happens. Yeah. I understand. Wow. I understand that.
Yeah?
Yeah, absolutely.
Are you socially awkward?
Yeah, I think
when you
so.
Were that age? I think everybody is, really.
Yeah, really. Yeah, especially.
I think everybody is, but some more than others.
Of course, yeah. Yeah.
Did you have a sister or brother or anybody to kind of bounce ideas off of?
My sister was 9 years older than me, and she really was more of a mother figure to me than my own mother. Not that my mother wasn't loving and didn't do everything she could to be the best mother that she could be, but she also had a little bit of Asperger's. Mm-hmm. This story will kind of sum it up. I wasn't as close to her as I would have liked. When I was in my early 20s, after I got back from my LDS mission, there was this girl that I knew before my mission. We had dated. We liked each other. And I thought this was the girl for me. I thought this was the perfect girl for me. I thought she felt the same way. And basically, she dumped me, and I was heartbroken.
Yeah.
You know, when you're that age, it seems like the end of the world. Now I laugh about it, but at the time, it seemed like the world was ending.
Mm-hmm.
So I was giving my mother a ride someplace, and I wanted to talk about it. And I told her what had happened. And she's like, oh, that's too bad. And then she immediately turned the conversation to the wonderful beans that her neighbor had made and how great these beans were.
Mm.
And she didn't do it maliciously.
No.
That's just how she was. You know, when my current wife, I dated her for a couple of years before we married. Just, you know, you want to be sure. It's a big commitment.
Yeah.
And my mother had only seen her around for like the 2 years before we got married. And so when we got engaged, I went over to tell my mother that we're getting married. And my mom said, great. Who to?
She didn't make the connection. Wow.
And she wasn't trying to be a jerk, because my mother wasn't a jerk. That's just how she was wired.
Well, and it's, I think what we're seeing, and this is where we talk about being present. And in any time of your any kind of social engagement, how present are you? Like fully listening and fully curious about what the other person is saying? And, you know, what we notice about some conversations is we can tell that that other person isn't listening. They're basically just waiting for us to stop so they can say their next thing that they're thinking of while we're talking.
Right.
And that's
right.
that's what we mean by presence.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
It might be a part of her spectrum symptoms, you know.
Mm-hmm. That I'm pretty sure it was. I don't hold it against her.
No.
She really tried very hard to let us know that we were loved and to provide our needs. So I think that's just the way she was, and I think she did the best she could, and I don't hold it against her at all.
Sure. So yeah. you go to your sister conversely, you know, and maybe she was more empathetic towards your broken heart.
Well, my sister was wonderful, and she's on the spectrum herself too. But she was wonderful. She taught me how to read when I was three. I remember playing with her. I never remember my mother reading a book to me or playing with me. I remember either playing by myself or with my sister. The bad thing about my sister was she was 9 years older than me.
Yeah, she was gone before you.
So. Yeah. We were at two completely different places, and she was out of there a couple months before she turned 17. She got a job as a nanny or something, and she was out as fast as she could.
Right.
Yeah.
But she was wonderful, and she was also a lifelong Mormon.
Yeah. Yeah. So fifth grade through 12th grade, you were basically an only child.
Yeah, basically. And I always felt like an only child even before that, because like I said, she was more like almost like a mother figure. She was the one that spent time with me, that played with me. Yeah. She's, you know, and she's a wonderful person. I love my sister. She's probably, other than my wife and children, the person I'm closest to.
Yeah. Is she still a Mormon?
She's still a Mormon. And as we get more in my story, there were some difficulties with her accepting my change of belief.
Yeah,
but I'm sure we'll talk about that. But
well, let's go ahead and talk about, because every denomination and every sect and even every religion varies on how severe excommunication is. So talk about Mormonism and how big a deal is it?
It's huge. You become persona non grata.
Yeah.
When you're excommunicated, you're allowed to come to church if you behave and sit there quietly. You can't speak in church. You can speak to someone. Someone says hello to you. You can say hello back. How are you doing? But, you know, Mormons at the local level don't have a paid clergy. So congregants give the talks, the sermons, the prayers. And when you're excommunicated, you basically are an observer. Mm-hmm. And if you're excommunicated and you're trying to repent and become a good Mormon and get rebaptized, people love you and are very, very supportive.
Yeah. Hmm.
If you're excommunicated or you leave because of lack of belief, and even if you're trying to be as gentle with the church as you can and not make waves and not, you know, ruin these social relationships, a lot of people kind of abandon you. I'd say about 80% of people I thought were my friends were basically my church friends. If I was doing everything they thought I should, I was their friend. But if I didn't believe.
Isn't that so? And so you're saying, Dave, that some people actually get excommunicated, then go back to church? I mean, screw them. Why would you go back?
What's the point? Here's why. Okay. Here's why. Because you're indoctrinated from the time you're born. You know, we have what we call fast and testimony meeting once a month. And that's for during the main hour and a half, the main meeting. People can go up to the stand and say whatever they want. Usually it's something along the lines of, I know Jesus is my savior. I know the Book of Mormon's true, et cetera, et cetera. Yeah. So they'll take little kids up there, 3 years old, and the parent will go up with them and they'll whisper what to tell them in their ear. You know, and the kid will say, I know Joseph Smith was a prophet. Then they'll pause while the parent tells them what to say next. I know that President Russell M. Nelson is a prophet today. And just on and on, and they don't know what they're saying.
Yeah, I'll say.
And wow. I have a family member that I love dearly, and I hope she doesn't listen to this because she'll probably get irritated with me. But I love this family member dearly in my extended family. She's almost like a daughter to me. And I recently saw her teaching her child to name the 12 apostles and the three apostles in the first presidency, a total of 15. So she showed them on the computer screen, and she points to each one, and the three-year-old kid with no hesitation says the name of each one. He knows all 15 of them. And she says, "Who are these people?" She says, "They're prophets." And she says, "Are they your best friends?" And the little three-year-old says, "Yeah, they're my best friends."
Yeah, right.
So you multiply that year after year, week after week, and it really it gets impregnated in your brain.
Yeah, I guess so.
So did you do a similar thing when you were a child?
I don't remember my mother ever doing that with me, but it was very, very common. But basically, so when I was a kid, you would go to church on Sunday. You would go to primary on Tuesday or Wednesday. Often there were activities on the Wednesday. There's just something three or four times a week that keeps you busy, that keeps you involved, and keeps you in.
Yeah.
So he's teaching his children about the apostles, which is what a good Mormon parent does. If you believe that these men are literally apostles in the same sense that Matthew, Peter, James, John were, mm-hmm. then a good parent teaches their children this. So she was doing what she believed was good for the child to teach them about
but
this.
But it's hard to watch, yeah.
It is.
Yeah. Okay, I want to go back and talk about your two-year mission. You're in a white shirt and tie. You're going door to door.
Yes.
How was that?
Yeah.
You know, I absolutely loved it because, again, with my black and white thinking, I literally believed I was representing Jesus Christ and that I was serving God and that I had some sort of special dispensation to go out and proselyte on his behalf.
Yep. You're commissioned. Go, wow. Go ye therefore. So there's a feeling of purpose. I'm doing, you know. Oh,
yes, yes. Yeah. And I took it very literally. I loved it. It was very hard work, a lot of rejection.
Yeah.
And you know, it was on my mission that I first kind of, my eyes started to open a little bit. Before my mission, I looked at all our local leaders, the bishops, the stake presidents, the different leaders, Sunday school teachers. I kind of put them up on a pedestal. And then on my mission, working closely with these people for the first time, I realized they're just men. And they have their good points and their bad points, but they're just men.
So you're a reader, and that's a dangerous thing when you're in a religion, because it's just a matter of time. I mean, people say all the time, I left the faith because I read the Bible. Mm-hmm. You thought I was going to say Hitchens or something, you know. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. It's reading their own text, and that's what you began to do, is study the history of Mormonism.
That was the beginning of the end for me. I love Mormonism. It was my tribe. It was my culture. And I thought to be the best Mormon, I had to learn as much as I could about it, the doctrine, the history, the sociology of it. And that's exactly what I did.
And that's what did it, huh? Among other things, I guess.
Among other things. It was not like an overnight thing. You know, it really started on my mission. I went on my mission in 1987. Which was approximately 9 years after the church decided to quit denying African Americans and black people the priesthood. Yeah. So, I went to Pittsburgh, which is very multi-ethnic, and I met a lot of people of all different ethnicities, and I would get asked about quite a bit. And basically, I would gaslight them because that's what, you know, I would minimize it because that's what I had been taught. You know, I would downplay it.
Oh, you'd gaslight them? Is that what you said?
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
I mean, it's there, but you're going to say it isn't, or almost. How would you do that?
Well, I would put a spin on it. It's not that the church has anything against black people. It's that, you know, the white people weren't ready for it. They weren't culturally ready for it. And just like in the Bible, at first, it was just the Jews that had the gospel. Then the day of Pentecost came and it expanded. And this was just another part of that pattern. Now the gospel is available to everybody.
Yeah.
Okay.
But that really wasn't true. I believed it was true at the time. But now if you go back and read some of the, you know, the statements and sermons of earlier church leaders, they just said horrendous things about anybody that wasn't white.
Wow.
But I didn't know that at the time. I wasn't trying to lie. I wasn't trying to gaslight.
Yeah.
That's just what I've been taught. And then, you know, it was on my mission. Other things started to come up. One thing that really bothered me on my mission, as you probably know, the church even today does not have the best relationship with the LGBT community.
Right. Yeah.
It can be a little bit old fashioned and it's thinking. So anyways, I was on my mission and my mission president called me and said, hey, we've got a special teaching case that I want to give you a heads up on that you're probably going to be involved with. There's a person, and he called this person a hermaphrodite. I think now the correct term is intersex. Mm-hmm. But basically, there was a person that had seen one of the videos on TV, the little 30-second advertisements, call this number, learn how you can be with your family together forever, get a free Book of Mormon.
And by the way, those videos, have you seen these, Bob?
Mm-mm.
They're really well done. They're really well done. They're very powerful.
Okay.
Anyway. Okay.
Yeah.
So this was a person, and I guess we're talking about with both genitalia.
Exactly.
Okay.
Yeah. They were born with both the male and female equipment.
And they wanted to have a visit. They requested a visit.
Right.
Okay.
Okay.
And normally, in the church, it would be the young missionaries that would go out and meet with this person. That's the standard operating procedure. Mm-hmm. But in this case, through the circumstances, they decided to have the leaders of the local congregation go out and decide what could be done. And my mission president was giving me a heads up because I think at that time he was thinking, they're going to talk to her, or we're going to figure out how to do this. And then when we're at that point, we young missionaries will come in and we'll teach her. But apparently this person was very interested in the church. He'd read the Book of Mormon. I can only imagine the isolation this person might have felt, you know, being in the unique circumstances they were. And they probably just were longing for community and belonging. And
yeah, sure.
I never meeting this person, but I'm told basically this person had the appearance of looking somewhat masculine, but identified as a female and would wear female clothes.
Okay.
So basically, the local leaders went out, and they had great concerns. They were worried, what's going to happen when this person comes to church and needs to use the restroom, and this person goes into the women's restroom, and all the ladies are going to freak out because this person's very masculine looking. Okay. And this really, really, really bothered me because, you know, I read in the Book of Mormon that all are alike unto God. Mm-hmm. You know, white, black, young, old, free, slave, all are alike, and at that time, I mistakenly believed that being gay was a sin. I didn't realize I had been taught, I'd been indoctrinated. It was basically a sin. It was evilness. Mm-hmm. But that clearly wasn't the case with this person. This person did not choose to be born, you know, with multiple different types of, you know, genitalia. It was not a choice. Mm-hmm. It was an accident of nature. It had nothing to do with anything she did. And the long story short, the church decided to walk away from this person and to not continue. And I just felt that was so wrong. Yeah. It just made me mad. I wanted to go out and introduce the gospel to everybody.
Mm-hmm. Wow.
Well, this reminds me of a book series that really changed my life. And it was called A New Kind of Christian by Brian McLaren, a series of trilogy of fictional stories. In the first book, I believe, if I'm not mistaken, that there was an intersexual person that got in the, you know, was in a part of the story. Mm. And just like David is expressing, this is a fly in the ointment. You know, this is not, what do we do with this?
Yeah.
And how does this fit into our construct of what of God's
this
world?
This one size fits all thing. Yeah, it's not going to work. Yeah, wow. So isn't that something? Well, you're a good guy, Dave, to look at that and say, well, that's not right.
And follow your heart. Yeah.
Yeah, I really wanted to teach this person. I wanted to.
I think one of the damaging concepts of Mormonism, and this is something that's not really stressed now. In fact, now the church would probably say, no, that's not true. We never taught that. But back then, you know, in the 70s and 80s, it was a common thought. And that was what Mormons believe in, what we call the pre-existence life. Existence did not start when we're born. Prior to birth, we lived with God and everybody before coming to earth.
Okay.
The concept was what you did in the pre-existence, how valiant and faithful you were in the pre-existence, kind of determine where you were born. If you were less valiant, you were born African American or black, and that's why you didn't have the priesthood. It wasn't a random thing. It's because you were less valiant. Now, if you were super, super valiant, you were born, like, you know, to the bishop's family or someone, you know, a very strong Mormon family. And, I was born into kind of a very poor family, no father, who at the time I resented. So that made me wonder,
oh my gosh,
what was I like that this was my slot? You know, I'm better off than the poor people in India because at least I'm white, which is a terrible way to think, but that's how we were taught.
Yeah.
Gee, what bullshit. You know? That is just a pile of never heard of bullshit right there.
And that kind of applied to, some Mormons would explain, well, this person that's intersex, they must have done something to be born that way,
Yeah.
And then also on the other hand, we would use the same concept to explain maybe people with Down syndrome. They were so righteous and valiant in the pre-existence that they just needed to get a body. They didn't need to go through and show that they can be faithful and get baptized and follow Christ. They just needed to come here to get a body and check that off the requirement.
Yeah.
So it went both ways.
My gosh, isn't that amazing? People are sure creative. I'm telling you, where do they come up with this stuff? That's great.
Well, that gives you license to, I think there is a place in the Old Testament where I think there's a reference that the inference is that black is a curse.
Oh, yeah. Because of the...
Wasn't it Cain and Abel?
It was Ham. Ham and Ham. Somebody. Ham and Moses or Ham and...
Well, Ham saw his father naked and drunk and got cursed for that. And
yeah, it wasn't Moses. It was I don't know.
Noah.
It was Noah. Yeah, that's right. It was Noah.
Noah was the drunk one, yeah.
Right. Yeah. Noah was drunk.
Right, and because Ham saw him naked, generations of people... Right. Were condemned to slavery and marginalized.
But what?
Because they saw their father drunk.
That's just off the chart.
It makes
crazy.
Perfect sense.
Does the Bible make some kind of reference to his skin color?
Was Shem, not Mark of Cain was something else, but the sin of Ham and the sons of Shem and the sons of Ham or something. But it goes back to that seeing the genitalia of Noah.
Okay, I looked it up.
Yeah, good.
The curse of Ham refers to the supposed curse upon Canaan, Ham's son, that was imposed by the biblical patriarch Noah.
Right.
The curse occurs in the book of Genesis and concerns Noah's drunkenness and the accompanying shameful act perpetrated by his son Ham, the father of Canaan. The controversies raised by this story regarding the nature of Ham's transgression and the question of why Noah cursed Canaan when Ham had sinned have been debated for over 2,000 years. The story's original purpose may have been to justify the subjection of the Canaanite people to the Israelites, but in later centuries, the narrative was interpreted by some Christians, Muslims, and Jews as an explanation for black sin as well as slavery. Nevertheless, most Christians, Muslims, and Jews now disagree with such interpretations because in the biblical text, Ham himself is not cursed, and race or skin is never mentioned. Skin color is never mentioned.
Isn't that something? That's just amazing to me.
Book of Mormon is even more specific. In the Book of Mormon, there were people that sailed over from Jerusalem to the New World, North or South America, and those that fell away from the faith, God cursed them with a black skin.
Oh, my.
Yeah. So there were the white and delightsome people, and there were the dark-skinned apostates.
Well, I think we can say all behavior and decisions and actions and words that a human being puts out there that's coming from a place of fear and insecurity is going to be toxic. And this is absolute insecurity. This whole thing is scared. You know, as far as the meaninglessness of life, the superiority that they need to feel over black people or whatever. Anyway, it's just all coming from a wicked place.
Yeah, I think so.
So in your research, I'm curious. I think, if I'm not mistaken, there's some money issues with Mormonism, right? I mean, like, isn't it a kind of... is there some greed involved as far as there's no pastors at the site, so all the money goes to the top? What do these guys make at the top?
So I was always taught that there was no paid clergy in the church. I was always taught that that was filthy lucre. and that the Bible counts against. And that was one of the marks of the true church. And at the local level, there is no paid clergy, but at the higher level, they're paid well. There were some pay stubs leaked a few years ago, and they were making the apostles like $120,000. This is like 10 years ago, plus all sorts of perks, you know, great health insurance. Their kids and grandchildren go to BYU University for free, you know, cars, stipends. So they're very, very well paid at the top.
Yeah.
And there's no transparency. Nobody really knows for sure how much money they make. There's estimates or what their holdings are, but, you know, we know it's pretty extensive.
Yeah.
And I remember just being shocked once I realized, you know, I didn't believe it and was looking for a community because I'd basically been shunned by 80% of them. Mm-hmm. I went to Unitarian Universalist church that met in a Presbyterian church, mm-hmm. and I was shocked in their kitchen big area where you eat or whatever. Mm-hmm. On the bulletin board, there was a financial statement, and you could see where every penny went. Mm-hmm. You know, the electric bill, the salary of the pastor, mm-hmm. and it just blew me away because it was so opposite. Yeah. You know, the transparency was so open. It just was mind-blowing to me, which it seems silly now, but it was.
Hmm. Yeah.
So, David, was there like the straw that broke the camel's back kind of thing? There were so many things piling up, or was there a triggering moment where you sort of said, "I'm out. That's it. That's enough. I can't handle it anymore."
There was a specific moment where 1 minute I believed, although liberally, I believed in the sense that, you know, maybe the Bible is more metaphorical, maybe the prophets and apostles aren't right about everything, but they're good people and they can still get communication from God. And what had happened was I was teaching what's called the Gospel Essentials class at church. I was a ward missionary. And this is where people that were new to the church or that had been away from the church for a while would go. So it was very, very basic, mm-hmm. kind of like a class you would teach, you know, maybe 10-year-olds, just very basic. Mm-hmm. And one of my ward missionaries was in there with me, and no matter what the topic was, he would bring up the concept of the coming cleansing of America. And this is the concept that sometime in the very near future, God is going to get so upset with America, with its wickedness, that he's just going to send, and they're not quite sure exactly what the mechanism is going to be, but there's going to be some sort of a natural disaster, a war, a plague, something's going to happen and kill about half the people, all the wicked people, and only righteous people will be left. And he brought this up on every Sunday. And it was a basic class. And I said, and I would ask him, you know, listen, we're talking about fasting, you know, mm-hmm. let's stick to the topic. And he'd say, okay. But then next week he'd be right back at it. And this happened day after day, week after week. Mm-hmm. So I decided he got his ideas from a book called The Coming Cleansing of America by Cleon Skousen, who was a very white right-wing author back in the day. He's passed on now, but he wrote this book. And I decided to get the book. I would read the book, and then I would show this other missionary how this concept was not doctrinal. And I would get him once and for all to shut up about it. So I got the book, started reading it. And the problem was it was 100% doctrinal. Mm. It quoted Mormon scripture. It quoted Mormon prophets and apostles. It was not something that was currently emphasized at church, but it was doctrinal. And I was about halfway through the book just reading about this vengeful God that's going to wipe out half of America and how it's coming really, really soon. And it was just like a light bulb went off. And I said, this concept is complete bullshit. Yeah. It is not true. But the problem was, if this concept was not true, and it was backed up by Mormon scripture, it was backed up by all the prophets and apostles, then they weren't true either.
Wow.
And I went from being a liberal believer to not believing at all just in 1 second. It was exactly like when you're a kid, 5 or 6 years old, and you're looking around the house when your mom's somewhere else, and it's a few days before Christmas, and you find a bunch of gift wrap presents in the closet. Mm-hmm. And you put two and two together. And once you put two and two together,
yeah.
it's really hard to believe in Santa Claus.
Yeah.
Yeah. No, I hear you.
Well, here's a case where your lack of ability to think abstractly and your black and whiteness, your literalness, you know, it's a part of your spectrum. This is what made you, you know, when we talk about the Jenga game or the cotter pin.
Yeah, right.
Because what you came to was, okay, I found, and it's kind of a little hidden doctrine that you'd gone all these years without hearing about it. Mm. Here it is. It was, sure enough, it's doctrinal. And you were, you know, you, I know you used the phrase, it's not true, but I think you also found it immoral.
Yeah.
And
right.
And so what, instead of being nuanced and just say, okay, this is where the prophets were off. This is the underbelly. This is the ugly side of this thing. But the main thing is still good. But, you know, your black and white thinking said, well, if this is wrong or this is not true, then none of it is true.
You know, at this time, while I think still I did have a lot of either or black and white thinking, I don't think I was as bad as when I was a youth, because at this point, I pretty much realized the Old Testament was a big turd pile. And I basically took the Old Testament as metaphorical. Basically, I believed at this point that the Old Testament was basically what a bunch of goat herders living 4,000 years ago would write.
Yeah.
When they were contemplating the universe. But I still believed in Jesus. I still believed in the modern church. So I wasn't as black and white, but obviously there was still some of that, yes.
Okay, so what age were you when this cotter pin fell?
This was not that long ago. I'm 50 now, so this was probably, I was probably about 45.
Wow.
And my reaction to my disbelief, I was panic stricken. Yes. I did not want to disbelieve.
Right.
For one thing, I had a good life. I have a wonderful wife. She was very Mormon. I felt like I had a community. I felt kind of like I belonged somewhat, you know, not perfectly belonged, but somewhat. Mm-hmm. And I did not want to disbelieve. And so I told myself, okay, Dave, you are going to study the Bible. You're going to study the Book of Mormon, the Mormon scriptures, the prophets. You're going to study Joseph Smith. You are going to reconstruct your belief. You are going to put it back together just like Humpty Dumpty. And, you know, obviously this can't be the fact that it's all true. That's not acceptable. We've got to find our belief. So I really embarked on an intense period of study. And
right.
Boy, it just made it worse. It got so, so much worse. It got so bad. Whereas, I mean, it just became so evident at that point. Every aspect you looked at, it just wasn't adding up.
Well, here's a case where education is good no matter what the outcome is. Because had you found good things and stuff that you could rebuild on, then you'd be back and you'd have mm-hmm. your faith back.
Right.
Or you're going, I think it's easier to leave something that you now have more conviction that this is bullshit.
Yeah.
You know, it wasn't a good place. I was not happy. I wanted it to be true.
Yeah, but when you discovered, you just said it got worse. I mean, it did. Was there ever a point when you felt like you're doing the right thing and you had some good feelings about leaving?
Oh, yes. After my intensive study, it just became obvious. And because I became aware, this isn't just a fairy tale that's not doing anybody any harm. If it gives people comfort, what's the damage? This is a system that oppresses people. It hurts people. Basically, if you're a straight white male, it's not too bad of a place. Mm-hmm. But if you're not white, if you're a woman, if you're gay or anywhere on that spectrum, it is just so harmful.
Yeah.
Wow.
Well, it's kind of that's America, but it's yeah. intensified by
that's
this,
right.
by this doctrine, these religions.
Well, you're a good person, David. I mean, really, you know, you look at it and go, well, wait a minute, that person is me. You know, why doesn't everybody get to play here? You know, which
right.
is, that I think is a very healthy way of living. And then you've got this ball and chain on you that's telling you something else. So, yeah.
And once I quit believing, I still kept going to church. I was the ward mission leader. I was going out with the full-time missionaries. We were teaching people. I still did that for about 2 years because I just wanted to make sure that I wasn't mistaken. I wanted to look at everything. I wanted to go into it wholeheartedly, hoping I would be wrong, but it became more and more obvious that if I can be blunt, it was all a fraud.
Yeah,
sure.
Well, let's talk about your family, your wife and kids. What how was the transition for them and where are they now?
So my wife, I thought she was pretty Mormon. And because, you know, we were very active, went every week, had callings, et cetera, et cetera.
I know.
I was so afraid to tell her because I would see there's different message boards for people that are doubting the church or don't believe the church. And it is so common when one spouse quits believing that the other one freaks out and becomes more Mormon forever than ever. And it has led to so many divorces, so much heartache, so many families broken up. And, you know, that's the last thing I wanted because I really love my wife. She is just, for me, she just fits me perfectly. Just we go together so well. And that's the last thing I wanted. So after about 6 months, I just had to tell her what the chips fall where they may. And so I told her. And the thing you have to understand about my wife, she is very analytical. She is very right brain. She's a civil engineer. She's a math whiz. Very logical, very analytical. So, and we had a great relationship. And we would, you know, we go hiking and walking a lot. We would talk about some of the things that bothered us, you know, like, you know, hey, the church is building a luxury mall in Salt Lake that costs somewhere between $2 and $5 billion. And wow, that really doesn't seem like something Christ would do. I mean, you don't, he said, sell everything you have and give it to the poor. Building a luxury mall kind of seems the opposite of that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So we would talk, but we wouldn't say the church is wrong. We'd just say, that's kind of weird, you know?
Yeah.
So I told her, you know, listen, and there's no easy way. I just said, I've been thinking and studying and praying. And oh boy, I prayed and prayed, but the heavens were closed. Yep. I so wanted to find God and commune with him. Nada.
Nada.
So anyways, I told her, hey, I've been studying, I've been praying, I've been reading, and basically I just don't believe the church is true anymore. And I think she was a little bit taken aback. You know, I think her eyes kind of missed it up a little bit, but she couldn't have handled it better. I think she knew my character, and she just said, well, tell me, why do you believe this way? I said, well, listen, I've got a couple of videos. Why don't we sit down and watch these videos on YouTube? One was by a fellow named John DeLynn that was in the news because he got excommunicated a couple of years, and he's seen as a critic of the church, but he never said anything that wasn't true. He made a video about why people leave the church, all the different doctrinal issues, all the different sociological issues. It's about a half an hour, 45 minutes long. We watched that. And then we watched a video by a gentleman named Grant Palmer. Grant Palmer was a teacher in the church educational system. He taught college students at their seminary. And he came to the conclusion that it was all a fraud. And he went through the origins of the church and looked at all the different things. And it just, none of it was adding up. And it just really, you know, Joseph Smith marrying 14-year-old girls, sending other men on missions and then marrying their wives, just all these things, the rock in the hat. He translated the Book of Mormon by taking a rock he found in a well, putting it in a hat, and sticking his head in the hat, which we had been taught he did it a completely different way. So we watched these videos, and at the end of about an hour, and she knew that I loved the church. She knew that I read and studied. She was furious at the church. After an hour, she was absolutely furious. She couldn't believe she had fallen for all that. And she had told me, you know, when I went to the temple the first time when we got married, she had told me she was pretty weirded out by it because the temple ceremony is pretty freaky.
Oh, she wasn't born Mormon?
No, but you don't go to the temple. Okay, so the temple is different from a church. You don't go to the temple. Usually when you're a man, you don't go until you're going on a mission. And if you're a woman, usually you don't go until you're getting married. Or if the right guy hasn't come along and you're getting on in years, then maybe you'll go. But it's completely different than going to church. You know, only Mormons, active, worthy Mormons are allowed in. And they just do some bizarre ceremonies. It's completely different from what you do at church. And you wear weird clothing. You say weird things.
Really?
And oh, gosh.
Is this the underwear, the underwear thing where you have to wear a certain kind of underwear?
That's where you get the underwear. You get it for the first time. It's called the garment. You get in the temple. You're told that it's something Adam and Eve had, only theirs were made out of animal skins. And you're given that, you're told never to wear it or to never not wear it again. You know, you're supposed to wear it the rest of your life.
Yeah. Yeah. Wow.
But that, if it was just the underwear, that's like the least weird thing about it. I mean, just, oh my God.
Tell us more.
I'm dying here.
Yeah. What other weird stuff goes on? It's fascinating, you know.
The clothing is bizarre. You wear what looks like it's an all-white costume with a green apron. It's very similar to the Masons. You wear like a baker's hat. And you go in there. Before you go the first time, they wash and anoint you. Now, in the old days, you used to stand naked in a tub, and these old men would put some olive oil on you and pray over you and touch you in different spots. When I went, you took off all your clothes, but they put this kind of shawl over you, kind of like a hospital gown that was open on the sides. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And so you get that ordinance, and then you go in to a room where you're waiting to go through the main ceremony.
Hold on a second. You're standing there, and people are bathing you?
Not really bathing, a little
but
bit.
They're touching you.
Sponge bathing. Yeah, old guys. And they like wash you and anoint you. You know, they'll not like your whole body from head to toe, but like a spot. I don't remember if it's like on your arm, on your breast, on your side.
Okay.
Yeah. And you know, they'll wash it, put on a drop of olive oil.
It's old guys that don't have any more sex drive. That's probably the reason that they have the old guys, you know, doing it. I could probably
I don't know
that
if it's
job.
Old guys, but when I went through it was old guys.
Okay.
and then someone comes in and you're in the room waiting to go in and start the ceremony. And just so you know, what I'm doing right now, describing the temple, this is about the worst thing you can do if you've ever been a Mormon.
It's
a secret.
You're not supposed to talk about it. Yeah.
You're not supposed to talk. This is what I'm doing right now. A lot of my family would probably disown me, but if that's the way it is, that's the way it is.
Yeah, I'm flipping them the bird by. This is evil.
Well, I hope
this is just evil stuff.
Yeah, me
not,
too.
Not your family. I'm flipping the religion the bird.
No, I understand. Yeah. I understand. Yeah.
Joseph Smith was a charlatan.
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely.
Yeah.
Although, you know, I don't know that he didn't come to believe in the lie. I think maybe it started out as a con, but I think he came to believe it.
Yeah.
Could be.
Okay.
Would be.
But that's debatable. But anyway, so back to the temple.
Yes.
You wait in the room and someone comes in like a man in a white suit or something. And he says, okay, if any of you don't want to go through this ceremony and take on these covenants that you'll be held to the rest of your life, leave now. And you have to agree to it then. You don't even know what you're agreeing to. And here's a part where my black and white thinking really came into play. As I told you, I took things very literally. Yep. So a common phrase in Mormon, if someone dies and they're not in Earth anymore, you say they're on the other side of the veil. And that means they're in the celestial realm with God or something.
Okay.
And in the temple, I didn't really get like any temple preparation classes. You know, well-meaning friends and leaders would tell me a little bit about it. And one of the things they told me is when you go to the temple, you will pass through the veil. You'll go through the other side of the veil where God is. And I took that literally. Mm-hmm. You know, it turns out there's a big white curtain. There's a person on the other side playing the role of God. And you do secret handshakes with him and you give him the passwords you learn. And then you go through the veil literally. Mm-hmm. But I really thought I was going to meet God in the temple. I really thought I was going to pass through the veil separating mortality and eternity, at least for a period of time. I thought I was actually going to meet God. And to be honest, I was terrified because I wasn't a bad person, but I was a teenage boy.
Sure.
You know how that goes.
Well, let me ask you something. How old are your children?
I've got a boy that is almost 12 and a girl that will be 16 in just a few weeks. And I'm teaching her how to drive, and that's terrifying too. But
so I guess how indoctrinated were they, and then how's their departure gone?
My boy was not very indoctrinated at all. He's also somewhere – We took him in to have him diagnosed, and they said, no, he's not autistic. But there's something – he's a great kid. He's super smart. but there's something a little bit off in the wiring where he takes things very literally too. Mm-hmm. And he really isn't, he's more down to earth and logical. He's really not interested in abstract concepts like God and religion. So he was 8 when we left. He was just about to turn 8. And that's a huge age when you're Mormon, because that's the age you get baptized. Mm-hmm. And they make a huge thing of it. When you're 7, the older people are constantly asking you when you're going to be baptized, and they're making a huge thing. So he was excited about being baptized. And we had all quit believing, and he wanted to be baptized, and he told us so. And I said, well, okay, if you want to get baptized, that's fine. I have no problem with that. I will support you. But you need to realize one thing. If you're getting baptized, you're making a commitment to God, and that means you need to go to church every Sunday. And he said, oh, never mind.
Never mind.
Right. And he never brought it up again.
That's great. Wow.
And he's not very religious. His brain doesn't work that way. He's more of, you can see it, touch it, feel it, smell it. That's what's real.
Gotcha. Yeah. How about your daughter?
My daughter, it's a more complex story. I think some people are naturally more prone to religion than others.
Absolutely.
And I think she is naturally more prone, and it's been, I think it's been as tough on her as anybody. Probably she's had the toughest go of it, because I think even now she still doesn't know what to think. And I don't, you know, I want to support her. You know, if I tell her I want her to be a good person, but if she wants to go to this church or go to that church, I'm supportive. I'll drive her. I'll go with her.
Okay, so she visits Christian churches, not Mormon?
She's a bit of an insomniac, just like I am, so she's not a morning person. I think if she was more of a morning person, she would. But I think she's still undecided. I think she's still undecided about Jesus, about God. She knows my opinion. I you know, we drive around, we do things together. I'm not shy about sharing my opinion. Mm-hmm. So I think logically she knows it just doesn't add up, but I think in her heart she's just, you know, she was in it long enough that it made a connection and a community. And
oh, yeah. Well, just like you didn't want to leave. It was hard. None of us. Like, even this week, my mom was kind of, for the first time in a long time, she was kind of preaching to me, you know, and she was like, all you got to do is believe. And I just said, I wish I could.
Yeah.
You know, yeah. I mean, sure. We need it to be true. I think that's maybe what your daughter's encountering is, like, I need, you're right about the degree of meaning making. Like, we're all meaning making, but some of us are really attached to those meanings.
Yeah.
It's a very comforting concept. Yep. You know, the concept that there is a loving God that has your back and will help you when things are rough.
Absolutely.
And even if life sucks, hey, life is just a short moment in eternity, and the heavens and the hereafter is going to be super groovy, and everything's going to be okay in the end.
And the cleansing's on the way.
Right. Wow. Oh, gosh.
Yes. Wow, isn't that something?
So your wife and you are kind of on the same page, and that's great that you made that transition. And you said
son
is there, daughters. I mean, and I think, obviously, you don't need my support, but I totally agree that you're supporting your daughter's free will and free agency to find her own path.
Yeah.
And, you know, I think for some people, leaving is not necessarily a good thing. Some people really have a hard life, and they need that social construct in their lives.
Yeah.
So, you know, I have people like that in my life, and they would probably be a mess if they left the church.
Okay. So in a way, that's slightly contradictory to what you said earlier in the show, and that is, this is not just some benign thing. This is toxic, you know.
Yeah. It's hurting people.
So clarify that for me.
You're absolutely right. It is contradictory. I think I have family members that basically the church and the community and the church is the only thing they have going for them.
I get it, yeah.
And I would hope that they would be nice to people, whether they're black, white, gay, straight. But I think that for some of them, they would just have a very, very hard time dealing with the repercussions.
Well, and I would say this as well. It doesn't serve us or anybody for us to wish things away when we know they're never going away.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Mm-hmm. I mean, that's exactly, you know, that expectation and attachment to outcome. Mm-hmm. No, I mean, we're not going to destroy Mormonism, especially in the lifetime of those beloved family members.
Right. Right.
So, no, it's not going anywhere. It might weaken. There might be less Mormons, but it's going to be around for some time.
Yeah. Yeah. And it's not our job to fix it or, you know, kill it.
You know, my wife she fast-tracked it. Once, you know, she was exposed to material, she went basically straight to atheism. Well, here's kind of the weird thing. After Mormonism, I said, well, okay, Mormonism is not true, but, you know, there's still Jesus. I need to figure out what type of a Christian to be.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So I was a Christian for about a week. I studied Christianity intensively, and I had never really studied anything Christian related except with a Mormon slant.
Right.
So I said, okay, I'm going to study the top scholars. I went, there's a professor at Yale that has an open course on the New Testament online, Dale Martin. He's a believer, although a liberal believer. Mm-hmm. I watched all 24 of his lectures. I read so many books, and for a week, I just ate, read, and slept the Bible. And it was just as obvious to me that there were some serious issues with the Bible.
Sure. You know, the picture I get is he's performing CPR on Jesus.
Yeah. I wanted keep him to alive. Keep my belief, but it just wasn't possible.
Yeah. I mean, what I mean by that is the urgency and the intensity of when somebody's, you know, whatever, they're down. Mm-hmm. And people just, they know that time is of the essence.
Yeah.
Right. And the urgency that you had to watch 24 videos and read these books in a week's time. Mm-hmm. It's just pump, pump, pump. Come on, Jesus. Come on. Come on, Jesus. Come on.
Yeah, right, right, right. Wow.
I really wanted to come to a different conclusion than what I came to, but it was pretty much undeniable. I read the Bible for the first time with my Mormon blinders off.
Yeah.
And I thought about what I read. I compared what I read, and just none of it meshed together. None of it made sense.
Yeah.
It didn't take long for me to say, well, yeah, I guess I'm agnostic, or at least I'm not Christian.
Yeah. Just a side note. You talked about how, you know, God has got your back. You'll be up in heaven with your loved ones, those kind of things, across the veil and all. Is there a heaven and is there a hell in Mormonism? I don't know.
Not in the traditional sense of it's a fiery place where you're tortured.
Yeah.
But there's a sense of a hell where you're separated from God and you're sad. Mm-hmm.
And you don't
not
see your family, I guess, right?
Now, so the interesting thing about Mormonism, so per Mormon doctrine, I'm apostate. I don't believe in Jesus. I'll be going to probably the lowest kingdom or maybe the middle kingdom because I'm a good person, but I won't be going to super VIP heaven. My relatives that do, they can come visit me in the lower kingdom. They can come visit me, see how I'm doing, say, hey, what's up, chew the fat. But then they go back, and basically I'm separated from God. I think Jesus can maybe visit the middle kingdom, but if you're in the lower kingdom, just your relatives.
My gosh, it sounds, like you're going to Mordor or something. You
know? But in the highest kingdom, it's awesome because I always thought of traditional Christianity, heaven, you're lounging around on a cloud, singing praises to God, strumming a harp. To me, that sounds boring after a couple millennia.
Sure.
In Mormon theology, you get your own planet. You become God.
Mm.
And I thought that was awesome. I was going to design some beautiful areas that would be great for hiking and, you know.
It's kind of like playing Sim City. You build it.
Exactly. Yeah. Exactly.
Isn't that nice?
Well, here's the thing that we know about lies. A lie is more believable the more elaborate it is.
Mm-hmm.
So I could say I flew in the air one time. But if I say on March 17th at 2 p.m. in Lubbock, Texas.
I'll never forget it.
I took off and I flew. You know, I just put some details on it.
Mm-hmm.
And just at least it makes it a little bit more, you know, get past your outer guard.
Mm.
And when they talk about these levels,
mm-hmm,
and everything that he said thus far, I mean, we're just scratching the surface, I'm sure.
Yeah,
right,
sure.
David?
we are.
Yeah.
Just it would take hours and hours to get fully into it.
Yeah, but these are the details that build up the lie. Mm. That's all I'm saying.
Yeah.
Right.
Right.
Okay, so what do you, you already said that you and your wife like to hike. I guess Bob and I like to ask people about the movies and TV series they watch.
Yeah, we love to hike, love to be outdoors. I'm really into musical theater. I started, I took my daughter to West Side Story when she was five. I had never really gone, and she just loved it so much. That that kind of became our thing to do. So,
oh, that's sweet.
That's great. Have you seen Book of Mormon?
I haven't seen it, but I have the CD, and I'm sure I will see. Just every time it's come to town, it's been like $300. And
I know, I'm it's like, expensive to see.
What's, yeah. the, what's the town that is local there?
Yeah.
Seattle.
Okay.
Oh, okay, so you're up
I had to leave Utah. I just couldn't stay there.
Yeah.
My friends were ignoring me in the grocery store.
Oh, wow. See, that's some the excommunication that I was asking about, right?
Yeah.
There.
Well, yeah. And, you know, and it wasn't just me. My whole family. There were kids that weren't allowed to play with my kids anymore.
Fuck that.
You know? So, yeah. That's I just – and now 20% of my neighbors were fine, were wonderful. But 80% would see me at the grocery store, people I thought were my friends, and they would turn and go the other way.
Okay. So what size town did you live in there?
This was very small. We lived in a town that was – in our ward, which is a local congregation, there was about 500 people in the area. In the little town I was in, there was maybe a couple hundred feet people.
So very rural.
Very rural.
All right.
And
so,
I loved it. It was beautiful, but I just couldn't coexist. I tried to. I wanted to.
That's you know, in a small town, you're just always going to run into those people.
Sure.
Oh, yeah. And one thing, and this might be hard for you to understand, this was in rural Utah. The area was about 95% Mormon.
Well, that's what my next question was, okay. How saturated?
Huh. Very. And even, you know, there was a lot of what we call Jack Mormons, which are people that like to drink and smoke and fool around. And so they're not active, but they still believe in the church and they'll still defend it. And they're not – those people, the regular Mormons view them as an opportunity for them to repent and for them to bring back in the fold. Me, I'm in direct opposition to God when I don't believe.
Wow. So you're in rural Utah, and then you move to Washington State. Is that right?
I just had to get out of Utah.
Yeah, I get you.
And I can't go. I really love the West and the North, trees and water, and I really couldn't go any further away and still be in the country. So,
That makes sense. So, and your job afforded you the opportunity, and your wife too. So you can move. There are some people, I guess, that can't move.
I work for myself. I'm a geologist, and the nature with computers and UPS, I could basically live anywhere as long as I had UPS and internet. So that wasn't a big issue.
Okay, great.
A geologist. What's a day in the life of?
Well, you know, it's funny. It's actually what I do is very light on geology. It's more like protecting water, like an environmental consultant. Like when they build construction projects, what methods they should use to protect nearby creeks and storm drains from getting pollutants.
That kind of stuff. Yeah, that's great. Yeah. So it's kind of an activist kind of thing too. But I was thinking, since you did have you do have probably an academic background in geology. I mean, my gosh, the stuff that you know about sediment and time and all that stuff, that can't fit with the beliefs of
six-day creationism
and stuff. Yeah.
Well, no, and when I started college, I was a young earth creationist, and I did believe in the Noah's flood was a literal event. And I started in psychology, realized that I would have to get a PhD if I wanted to do anything. I was fascinated by psychology, but I really didn't want to do it for a living. Mm-hmm. And I like being outdoors, so I went into geology. And by the time you're through, you know, you learn how to read the rocks, and it's just as plain as the nose on your face that the earth is very, very ancient. And it's just as plain. Maybe there was some sort of a regional flood in the Mediterranean at some point. I'm sure there was. Yeah. But it's plain. I mean, no question that there was not a worldwide flood. Oh, it's just – and see, the problem is Jesus took the flood literally. Mormon scripture all falls apart if the earth is not 6,000 years. If there was life before Adam, that screws up the whole theology.
Wow.
You know.
Well, what do you expect? I mean, these people were, like you said, goat herders. They didn't know germ theory. They didn't have any clue about.
Well, and they thought their world was the world.
That was the world, right? And so,
and they were the chosen people.
Yeah.
Had no idea how big the world was.
I mean, you know. In a way, you can kind of forgive them that.
There you go. Yeah.
But we know now what's up with us. You know what I
mean? Yeah, why? Yeah, we have no excuse.
Yeah, exactly. Sorry, go ahead, Dave.
The Bible reads exactly what you would expect a book written 4,000 years ago by a nomadic people to write and believe in.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. It makes perfect sense in that context.
Sure, sure, absolutely.
Well, let me ask you, you mentioned in your bio that at you know, you used to be politically very, very conservative. And I'm curious as a couple of things. One, is that typical of Mormons? And number two, how has your deconstruction and departure from Mormonism affected your political stance?
You know, my that played a huge role. I haven't mentioned it, but it's good you brought it up because that was huge. So I was so concerned. Mormons are typically Republican. The church does not have an active political stance, but in the county I was, which is a rural Utah county, it was probably 95% LDS and 99% Republican or similar conservative. There are some fringe parties that were even more conservative than Republicans. And so I would read the Bible, and basically Jesus, when you really start reading it and think about it, he was basically a socialist hippie type of guy. He was anything but Republican or conservative. He was a revolutionary, you know, and it just, you know, one of the things that was big at this time was, well, President Obama was in office. You would not believe the most hateful things I heard about President Obama, even over the pulpit. You know, he's a devil. He's the Antichrist. Just horrible, horrible things. And then, you know, he started to get behind Obamacare, which I thought was a great idea. I thought, you know, it's a shame that in our country there's people that are dying because they don't have proper health care. When I discussed this with some of my neighbors and friends, their response was, well, you know, if you don't have insurance and you die, at least you die in Christ, so it's all okay. And basically, I was pretty conservative. I used to think Rush Limbaugh was not conservative enough. I used to get mad at him when I'd listen to him on the radio. But the people around me were so ultra super conservative that it kind of had a backlash effect on me, because I just said, you know, this really is kind of crazy.
Yeah.
And the more I read about Jesus, he was not a Republican. You know,
I could say the same. It was part of my deconstruction and deconversion, because it just flew in the face of like, what? This is contradictory. I mean, it's just... So well, I guess let's wrap it up with, are you, I mean, you've got notes, and you got anything you want to tack on here at the end?
Yeah. What did we miss?
You know, we could probably do this for several hours more. I think we've hit the high points.
Well, I'm glad you came on. This is we've never, especially a Mormon that was Mormon for 47 years, we've had little versions of Mormonism. There's some sects of Mormonism that we didn't know about. I didn't know about.
No, it really is fascinating.
There's tons of, probably in the hundreds of
offshoots.
Sects. Yeah. Yeah. Mm-hmm. We had where I was, we actually had a lot of polygamists in the county I was in.
Wow. Practicing?
Oh, yeah. And you know, it's funny because sometimes – okay, so not all polygamists believe the Mormon church is evil or fallen away. Some polygamists believe that the Mormon church is still good and still valid, but they've been called to live a higher way. So sometimes they're polygamists, but they secretly attend the Mormon church. I was a ward missionary for a long time. Going around trying to convert people, and in that area when everyone was already Mormon, it was more trying to get them to come back when they had children, getting their children baptized. But I remember going into a house one time and hanging up, there was a portrait over the doorway of the third president of the Mormon church. I think it was Wilford Woodruff. And that was very unusual, because often you see pictures of Christ, often you see pictures of the current prophet. You see a lot of pictures of Joseph Smith, the founder, but you never see the third guy. But what the significance was, he was the guy, they think he was the last true Mormon prophet, that after that it went off the rails. That's when they started practicing polygamy, because the Mormons had to stop practicing polygamy because the federal government was confiscating all their property. They were arresting all the polygamists. It was, you know, they were being shut down.
Right, right, yeah.
Well, it's interesting today because, I mean, right now, you know, there's a lot of people that have open marriages or they're polyamorous.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, everybody judges the polygamist as evil, and yet it's kind of become a more culturally accepted thing. Not necessarily the marriage, but just open.
Yeah.
I think the one of the biggest ironies in the world is Mormons, with their founder's background and their early history of polygamy, telling anybody else what marriage should or shouldn't be.
Yeah.
It just, yeah. You know.
It's weird. I agree. Very strange.
Well, thanks for coming on. I've really enjoyed it. And, you know, Bob and I are both fascinated with this was news to me. A lot of times I'm already aware of everything the guest is going to say about right. Christianity. And this was enlightening for both of us.
Yeah, it was quite something.
Well, you know, we've really just scratched the surface. Yeah. There's very superficial, but I think you get the gist of it.
Well, I'll be honest with you. I don't know if I could stomach anymore because I'm getting madder and madder.
Yeah.
Well, you know, and there are good parts about being Mormon. It's not all bad. The sense of community.
Oh, for sure.
My gosh. You get sick. You need someone to watch your kids because you're having an operation. The community rallies around you. They help you. If you're a believing Mormon, you get such a strong support system.
Right, right.
You know, and it's hard to replace that community. You know, I've tried, but, you know, even though I don't believe it at all, Mormonism is my tribe.
Mm. Yeah.
And I'll always be Mormon. And it's not easy to replace that big of a social structure. Mm. It's just not.
So what have you done to try?
There's two main things. When I first left, I went to a UU, Unitarian Universalist Church.
Yeah.
That was 45 minutes away, made up mostly of ex-Mormons, and that really saved my life. Just, it was so different, so new, so supportive. Then when I moved, there were two things. There's where I am, and in most larger areas, there's usually communities of former Mormons, non-believing Mormons, unorthodox Mormons, and it's a very tight-knit, close community. The friendships we make are they're just stronger. They're more real. It's not based on you towing the line. If you totally believe that Jesus Christ is the Savior and I believe that he was a crazy person, it's not a big deal, you know?
Yeah, that's great. So, you know,
a local community of agnostics and atheists. They're not my tribe, but they're becoming my tribe slowly.
I get you. Sure. You know, I don't want to take us off down memory lane here, but is it Ancestry.com or 23andMe or one of those services that check your genetics? Aren't they in some way associated with the Mormon Church? Is it Ancestry?
I think I know Ancestry.com, and I think they might have acquired some of the other companies. Oh. The people that started it were believing Mormon, and I don't know if it's still the case, but I know as of a few years ago when I was in the church that all Mormons had like a free subscription to it. You could get your password and login. You didn't have to pay for it. And Mormons are huge on genealogy.
Yeah, exactly.
They spend so much money on these temples where you go in and do ordinances for people that have passed on.
Right.
The amount of money and manpower that you could be in the community teaching kids how to read, tutoring kids, making the community a better place. It's just wasted time and money.
Yeah.
Wow. Isn't that something? Yeah, that's a big deal. I know. In fact, you can convert people that are dead to Mormonism.
Oh, yeah.
To Mormonism.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. The Mormons are going to get you one way or another.
Yeah.
You know, Adolf Hitler's a Mormon now. You know.
How is that?
They get you.
How is that even possible to convert somebody when they're dead? I mean, they can't say yes or no. Well there you go.
There's not a damn thing about anything that he's said today about them that's possible or believable.
I know.
Per the Mormon concept, so say a person dies, they never even heard of Mormonism, never even heard of Jesus Christ. Mm-hmm. You do the ordinances for them, baptism, marriage. If they're male, you give them the priesthood. And then when they're on the other side, they get taught the gospel. And if they accept it, if they choose to, and I think most of them would, because, you know, when you're on the other side, you have more knowledge, then you accept the baptism and the ordinances, but you're not forced to.
Yeah. Okay. Of those things you just listed, I can see where somebody would vicariously be baptized on behalf of the dead.
Okay.
But that second thing you said was marry them.
Okay, so basically all the ordinances you do in life, like I described going to the temple and being washing and anointed, and then baptized, and then eternal marriage. You can't get into the highest levels of heaven unless you're married in the proper way by Mormon authority.
Okay.
So everything that a good Mormon would do in life, the same thing is done for the people in the temple, the washings and anointings, the baptism.
No, but I'm asking about the dead guy. How do you marry the dead guy?
Oh, well, they just have an ordinance. There's a guy in a white suit. He brings up a man and a woman that are acting vicariously.
Ah, I see.
Oh, boy.
So they say, David Burns acting for and behalf of John Smith. Do you take this woman, Jane Doe, acting for and behalf of so-and-so?
All right. So I'm standing there, and I'm going to be laughing under my breath. This is, I mean, that doesn't pass the laugh test, man.
I mean, but what's interesting too, David, is that I'm sure people sat around a big mahogany table somewhere and saying, okay, here's the way we're going to do it. And everybody went, yeah, there's a great idea right there. We'll have a couple of people pretend like they're the dead.
Here's the thing. When I was getting in my stages of disbelief and I really wasn't getting along with my local leadership, because you can imagine I wasn't falling in.
Yeah.
You know, when they said jump, I didn't say how high. I said why.
Yeah.
You know, basically.
Yeah, sure.
So I got a calling to work at the temple, and two or three times a month I would go down there, usually for 4 or 5 hours at a time, and I would sit there, and we would do those ordinances one after another, mind-numbing boringness for hours. And then I would take breaks when the endowment session was getting out and go work over there for 15 minutes when they need me. Then I'd come back and do it again. And I thought it was fantastic. Mm-hmm. I thought, man, we're saving people. We're allowing them to be with their families in the next world. I thought it was wonderful.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Well, sure. If you believe it, it is.
Yeah. No, I get you.
I remember one time this guy got saved, and you know, after the service, everybody parades by them and congratulates and shakes their hand and welcomes them into the fold. Mm-hmm. And one of the kids in the youth group walked by, shook this guy's hand, and he said, good move.
Good move?
Yeah, choosing eternal life.
Yeah, good move.
Good move.
Wow.
Yep.
It is a good move. I mean, it's presented in a way where you'd be an idiot not to accept it. Mm.
You know, you really don't have a choice, because you don't know anything different. It's so pounded into you.
Yeah.
You really, and they don't encourage you to. So when I started reading all these books by other scholars, that was the first time I ever read anything that was by non-Mormons.
Yeah.
They don't encourage you. They say stick to the approved material.
All right.
Sure.
Well, let's wrap it up. What are you going to, it's Saturday. What are you going to do for the rest of the weekend?
You know, it's looking nice. We might go for a hike or something.
All right.
How cold is it there now?
It's about highs of 50. It was pretty windy the last few days and pretty rainy. But summer's coming. We'll have like 3 or 4 days that are kind of soggy and wet. Then we'll have 3 or 4 days that are just out of heaven.
Sure. David, are you? Do you drink coffee now, or are you a beer drinker, or do you take a little schnapps from time to time?
What? I would have left Mormonism when I was 20 if I would have known how awesome coffee was. It has changed my life. I'm a bit of an insomniac, and coffee helps me function. It helps me keep to a semi-normal schedule, and I just love it. As far as alcohol, I think it's kind of an acquired taste.
Mm-hmm.
When I go out, you know, and I meet with my friends that are ex-Mormon or my friends that are agnostic, they all drink, so I'll have a drink or two to be social. But I really, I don't really ever get buzzed, and it just the taste, I really don't care for it. I think it's acquired.
Okay. Is that the beer you're talking about? Or
beer, wine. Okay. So if I do drink alcohol, I stick to, you know, cocktails, something that kind of
tastes good. Yeah.
Yeah. But even then, I'm still like, yeah, this is kind of, yeah.
Well, like you're a good guy. You're a good guy.
But I love coffee. I think, oh my gosh, you could put an IV in my veins with coffee and I'd be happy.
Okay.
All right. Well, thanks a lot.
Great, David. Thanks, man. Great talking to you.
I've enjoyed it. You guys have a good, let me just tell you one thing. You'll find this interesting.
All right.
So I listen to a lot of podcasts. There's several on my regular rotation. When I'm out hiking in the woods by myself, my absolute favorite podcast to listen to is Everyone's Agnostic. For some reason, for that activity, I just find you guys so calm and reasonable and soothing. And when I'm out there just around, you know, the beauty of the mountains and the forests and
oh, wow.
It's my favorite podcast for hiking.
Well, we're honored.
Yes, we are. We should put that as a logo. Your favorite hiking podcast. I love it.
You know, you guys, I'm trying to let go of the hurt and the anger, and you guys are so helpful for that because you guys take such a reasonable position.
Oh, wow.
And, you know, the church isn't going anywhere. Christians aren't going anywhere.
Yeah.
So instead of being angry and banging your head against the wall, you need to release, accept, and just kind of let it go, because it doesn't do you any good. It's a normal reaction to feel betrayed and to feel anger, mm-hmm. but to keep hanging on to it isn't healthy.
Yeah. Great advice.
Absolutely. Say yes to what is, right?
Yes to what is. Well, thank you so much, guys. I've enjoyed it.
It was our pleasure, Dave. Thanks, man. David Burns.
Good guy.
I like him. Yeah.
When you give your life to 47 years, first 47 years of your life to something, it mm-hmm. is, we talk about the water you're swimming in, but that's like that they didn't know anything else.
Yeah.
And I think that immersion, I know that's part of their intent.
Sure.
Don't associate with people outside or, you know, mm-hmm. whatever.
It'll very taint you in some way.
Inclusive, yeah. You know,
yeah.
Tight. And just to walk right into it, we talk about this, you don't, as a child, you walk right into it, and it's just, mm-hmm. I don't know. And I think he said there at the end, I'm not angry. I mean, because a lot of us say, I want those years back.
Right.
And I didn't sense, he really kind of, he said, I'll always be a Mormon.
Mm-hmm.
That's how ingrained it is. That cleansing thing, I did not know this about Mormonism, and he didn't either after even being in it for decades. It comes up a lot, and there's a TV show, I think it's on Hulu, called The Path.
Yeah, I've heard of
that.
In
these later episodes, in this, I think, second season, there is a sect of this particular cult that believes that the cleansing is coming, and it's right, you know.
Oh.
And when it doesn't, you know, they're like, well, what happened? I mean, you have people, and this is what the case is here. You have people anticipating genocide.
Yeah.
I think when you have expectations of how the world should be, and when it's not, you're like, well, the kingdom come on earth as it is in heaven. You try to change it. And then after a while, you give up, and you say, it just needs to be flushed down the toilet. Mm-hmm. Drain the swamp, you know, and you look forward to it.
Yeah.
Right now, mm-hmm. people, a lot of Christians that are just, they lack ecological convictions about saving the earth, because the sooner Jesus comes back, the better. So this is how twisted it can get. That's all
I'm saying. No, I hear you. And it is, in that way, it's very scary to me.
Oh yeah,
because if these people take over the reins of power, the control of power.
Well, even the voting bloc.
Yeah,
that's what gave us Trump.
Yeah. My, we do have a problem.
Religion poisons everything.
Well, yeah, it doesn't have to, but it seems to, doesn't it?
It's a controversial statement. I was just quoting Hitchens, but
yeah,
it does seem to.
It seems like there's more bad stuff than good stuff. And I understand there is good stuff, too. But, man.
Okay, but here's the point.
Maybe it's all anecdotal. Yeah.
You take a person and you insert religion into their life. Religion is going to help them. If they're a good person, it's going to enhance their goodness and mm-hmm. probably give them a platform and means and resources. Mm-hmm. But what religion does is it's the only thing, maybe that's an absolute, but it takes otherwise good people and who would never even think of, like, you know, what of wishing genocide upon the earth.
Yeah.
You know, it's I forget the way that's phrased, that, you know, that religion's the only thing that make a good person do a bad thing.
Right, right. Like,
and so the fact that there's good things coming out of the church, Hitchens' point is that there's not one good thing that the church does that couldn't be done without it.
Oh, I see.
Like without the overarching narrative.
Sure.
Good people just doing good things. But there are evils that we as a species do that we would never imagine. He uses the example of genital mutilation.
Oh, right.
That it would never occur to somebody
to a normal person
looking. You know, yeah, they got to cut this off. You know, yeah, or whatever. Just whatever you think. Or in the case of this Mormon situation, just we've got to come up yeah, with layers of heaven and
I know. In fact, I have a couple of books on mutilation,
circumcision,
genital mutilation for the boy, and other mutilation for the females as well. And I get the covenant and I get all that stuff about, it's a rule, it's a law. And, but still, who was the one that said, cut the top of your penis off. There you go. Yeah. Now you're in a religion. Now you're in the right religion.
Well,
are you kidding me?
I've always wondered why it was a mark, because you can't. It's not like you're walking down the street and say, he's one of us.
Yeah, let's pull your pants down and check that out or something. That would be an interesting show. Why do we do these things?
Yeah. Well, there isn't. I mean,
it's lost in history, maybe.
Meaning-making storytelling.
Yeah,
and
could be.
And I guess we could say, on a positive note, look at the creativity of humankind. That's what you say all the time.
That's amazing, the creativity you guys have. Where'd you come up with that? How could you, I can't think of that.
As a writer, you're like, oh, man, I wish I'd have thought of that.
Exactly. Or not, as it were.
Yeah, like you said, if you're in that meeting and somebody comes up with that, where's the guy who says, bad idea?
Really, boys? We got to put that aside here. No?
Where's that guy?
I don't know. He's apparently elsewhere. Yeah. Drinking, having coffee, doing whatever.
Speaking of drinking and having coffee, let's
do that.
Let's go think and stink.
Okay. And we'll try it again next week. All right. Thanks, Cass.
See ya.